people don't know how to be this person's friend. And I also feel, Sean, like people get tired of looking for their person. And so they kind of like settle for this is okay or this is good enough. And so they don't truly experience what love is. And so they find themselves in a marriage that's just kind of like, we here.
Today's guest is a relationship coach for divorcees. This is why I had to have her on the show. And she's also a blogger. She has a crazy amount of content on Twitter and on Facebook. You got to go check her out, Bravehearts Community. Let's show some love to Nayla. How are you doing this evening?
I'm good. Thank you so much for having me on.
No problem. Finally, we're able to make this happen.
I know.
Let's jump right into this because I want to make sure that I honor your time. You talked about going through a divorce. I was checking out the website. And what did you learn from your divorce? And what advice would you give to those who desire to marry?
To marry or to marry again?
Oh, yeah, to marry again. Yeah, there's a difference.
Okay. So I think the toughest lesson, I'm from the islands, and it's Nyla. You keep pronouncing it wrong.
I'm sorry. I didn't call you Nyla?
No.
Ooh, I'm sorry, Nyla.
It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. It's okay. So I'm from the islands, and I think one thing that I learned from my divorce is that once respect is out the window, you can't go back. And so as I moved forward in my relationship after, that was something that I really, really worked hard on. I got a little bit of a temper, just a little bit. I'm from Trinidad, you know, that's just how we are. And so if it's one thing that I learned, it's just to, sometimes we just gotta be quiet as women. And we don't know how to always do that because we always wanna clap back. We always want to have the last word. We always just wanna get our part out there. Sometimes it's just about sitting down and being quiet. Because here's the thing, once you release something, once you say something, you can apologize for it. But if you've disrespected your partner in any way, you can't take it back. And so if there's one thing I've learned, is to just shut up sometimes.
Hey, that's a great piece of advice.
We don't know how to do that well as women.
So, do people still desire marriage as we go into 2023?
I think it depends on who you're asking. I think people look at marriage as something completely different. So, I think it depends on who you're asking. Some people just see it as something that locks you into that person, something that's beneficial in some sort of way, whether it's for to get benefits. If something happens to that person, you have some kind of security, which is fine, to each his own. But there are a lot of people that I think people don't believe in love anymore. I think they're afraid of what it really takes to be in love. It looks beautiful. You see it on social media. You see all the photos. It looks beautiful and it looks so amazing. And marriage is so, but it's like, it's so much work to maintain in a healthy relationship, not just marriage. Marriage is like, we locked in, we lifers, we doing this. And I don't think people are really ready for the work that's involved with marriage. They just want, you know, to post the pictures, to post the beautiful captions. It's not always beautiful. You have to love that person, even when you don't like that person. People don't know how to be this person's friend. And I also feel, Sean, like people get tired of looking for their person. And so they kind of like settle for, this is okay, or this is good enough. And so they don't truly experience what love is. And so they find themselves in a marriage that's just kind of like, we here. And it's like, you're not happy, I'm not happy, but, you know, financially, we're both, you know, we have all these beautiful things because, you know, we're joint now. And it's like all the bells and whistles of what marriage is, but there's no love, there's no devotion, there's no passion there.
And you said something that I found interesting. So you're saying that people basically, you think a lot of times people settle?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Definitely. Men and women. It's not just one sex, it's both. Mm-hmm.
Because in this social media world, I mean, we got options. Mm-hmm. You know,
That's what
I
it tries.
guess.
Yeah, that's what you think. Yeah. You think you have so many options, but it's like, but you have options when you're not content with who you chose, right? Because when you know you pick the one, that person can work your very last nerve. But you're like, we good here. I don't like you. I dislike you, but I'll make sure you eat. I'm gonna make sure that you're taken care of. I'm gonna ask you how your day is, even if I really don't wanna care, even if I'm like 50% like not listening to you. You make yourself be involved, stay consistent because you care about that person. And so it's so important to, like, you know, be your partner's friend. Because again, like, I feel like so many people focus on just the glamour of it all and not what it is in actuality.
Yeah, because I can say I've been through a divorce, and one of the issues that happened in my marriage was I believe we weren't best friends. You know, I think there was a little pressure there, you know, and there's a whole backstory with that. But when I look back, I see now that I'm remarried, I'm like, my wife is my best friend. Like, I can't see, it's one thing for her to be my wife, but it's another thing for her to be my best friend. I'm like, I don't want to hurt my best friend. You know, so
Definitely.
it feels a little different. You know.
And that's the thing. Like, I feel like sometimes when people, you know, they've done it before, you should be smarter. You should be thinking, okay, what did I do that was wrong in the last situation? And listen, a lot of people don't want to do that. A lot of people don't want to self-reflect. A lot of people are like, oh, she messed up or he messed up. We both did. Like, we're human beings. We are imperfect. And so we're gonna make mistakes. We're gonna mess up. Like I said, my thing was my mouth. And like at first, like, you know, when we were like going through our turmoil, it was like he would say stuff to me and I'm like, you know what? I'm just gonna chill. I'm just gonna chill. He's like, okay, well, you know, Jesus said turn the other cheek, so I'm turn the other cheek. And then after a while it's like, oh, you really don't know who you're playing with. And so it just was like, you say something, I'm gonna say something worse. That is so unhealthy. You
Yes.
know? And so in my relationship now, even if I don't like what my partner is saying, I swallow an air bubble. You know how kids, you tell them just swallow a bubble so that they can shut up? Swallow a bubble, just take a minute.
I would
And my
go
eyebrows.
for Yeah, I would go for the jugular, but
I know if I open my mouth, something potentially may not come out that would benefit me and my person. So I'm gonna just swallow this air bubble real quick. Okay. Yeah, swallow this air bubble.
So what, where was the switch for you when you went through a divorce? You were saying about, you know, your mouth, your tongue. When did that switch come on for you? Was it after the divorce or like, when did
No,
it change?
it was during the divorce. It was kind of like at the end, and it was just like, this person keeps hurting me and I keep hurting them. This is not healthy. This is not okay. Like, because I mean, it was really bad. Because I'm like, you are coming for me, and you know, we got to put the hair up because it's on. It's on. You know, and that's so unhealthy. And sometimes we get so comfortable in that toxicity. We get so complacent, like, you know, that's just what it is. No, that's not okay. It's not okay. And I realized that once the respect was gone, I mean, I sit back now like, wow, like you really said some foul stuff to this person. But it got to a point where it's just like my back is against the wall and you are like punching and swinging at me. So I'm going to come out this corner swinging too. But that's not healthy. And that's not conducive to a healthy relationship, let alone marriage. And then we have little kids. So now my children are watching and or they're hearing. I don't want this for them. And so I'm like, okay, hold up. How can I fix this? We tried counseling and you know, we did what I believe we've exhausted everything. But it just you both have to be willing to do the work. You know, people who've been married for 30, 40 plus years, it has not always been good. It has not always been beautiful. There's times when you're probably like, F this, I'm out. You choose to stay in that relationship. You choose to be respectful of your partner. You choose to love them, even though you may not be in love with them. Folks nowadays, it's like, oh, well, we're not in love anymore. Find it. Do things to get back to you too. Mm-hmm. And you choose to stay. You choose to work in it, to stay focused. Date night. Once you get with your person, you're like, oh yeah, no, we don't have to go out, because men don't like to go on dates. What is that about? I don't even understand that. I don't understand it. Like, sir, what? Who doesn't like to go on a date? But you have to continue doing those things to keep things fresh and, you know, switch things up to do things outside of the norm for you and your person.
That's true. What do you see? What do you think is the biggest mistake from you coaching wives? What do you think their biggest mistake is in marriage?
I don't want to comparison. Comparison is truly the thief of all joy. We see things on social media and we look at our man like, you're not doing that. I don't get flowers, or I don't do this, or I don't get that. Look at all the things that I do for you. You listen, you never know what is truly happening behind closed doors with these couples. And so sometimes those glamorous things, you just like, okay. And I really feel like it is comparison, because there's somebody else who's doing something else better than you. And there's somebody else, a husband or a wife, is doing something better than your partner. But there's also things that your husband is doing that their husband may not be doing. So it's kind of like, you know, just, I think sometimes you just gotta see who you married or see who you're in love with and accept that person. And sometimes it's hard, you know, because I'm a romantic and my partner is not. He's so not. If I left him to play on the game all day, he would be happy. This is all we're gonna do today. This is our date night this week. Okay, got it. And if I left him, and if I didn't push him, he wouldn't. But there's limitations, you know, because I could be in a situation where, like, oh my God, he's not at home. He's not spending time with me. So again, you know, it's comparison. You have to know who you married, or you have to know who your partner is, and stop trying to compare yourself to what you think something else might be, because a lot of times it may not. Not saying that there aren't beautiful couples out here. Not saying that men can't shower women, but your partner and the way that he loves you and vice versa is not going to be the same as someone else's. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I remember one time there was a couple we had over our house, and I was washing dishes because they getting ready to leave. I think it was my son's birthday, and we're cleaning up the house, and she says, see, he washes the dishes. And I told her right then, I said, don't do that. I said, don't, let's not do that. You know, because like you said, her husband can be better than me in a certain area where I suck, you know, and she not going to want to trade that in.
Right.
So we all have, and I like that you said that, we all have those, you know, the give and take things that you might be better, and vice versa. So, because some people, they don't look at that. They focus on them negatives and they want to run with it.
Yeah. And it's that whole 80-20 rule. You're going to give up all of these amazing qualities that your person has because of this little thing, you know? Okay, so her husband might be showering her with gifts and flying her out everywhere, but he's cheating. She hasn't shared that with you, though. You know, it's just like, cheating versus not being super romantic and giving me gifts. Like, come on. We don't see everything because it's not our marriage. So we don't have access and privilege to those things. Mm. But comparison is truly the thief of all joy. Mm.
Yeah, because I think when we were growing up, I guess I'm telling my age, in our neighborhood, you only had so many people in the street that you knew. You knew Miss Johnson and her husband. You knew, you know, you went to school, you seen your friend's parents or vice versa. But now you got the whole world in your hand.
Yes. Because even like Derek Jackson, the coach, I'm sure you know the whole story.
Yeah.
When he posted photos with his family, it's just like, oh my God, just beautiful, just beautiful. And the truth years later, so again, you don't want to look at somebody's situation and say, oh, I wish that were me. Because you don't know what you're wishing for. That's why the Bible said, you know, that you shouldn't covet. But again, it just, social media is just, it only captures snapshots. It is not what life is really like. We're not posting the tragic moments, the tough moments. You share that with your circle, the people that you trust. You're not posting that. And even if you don't, even if you do, you know, your happy anniversary post or whatever, you're like, you know, we've been through so much this year. You're not really talking about what it is that you've been through, what it is that you've experienced. You're just kind of like skimming over the bad part, highlighting all the good parts. Again, snapshot.
Yeah. Yeah. And do you think maybe is that because the world can't handle, I won't say the truth, when you got the world in your hand, right? But do you think being transparent can almost kind of, I won't say damage your relationship, but people just can't handle your honesty and what things what you've been through? Because people will come for you.
Okay, so it's kind of like on the fence about this part. Like,
okay.
I love seeing couples in love. I love the post. You know, I love seeing real couples being authentic. And then you can have the couples that you can tell they're like, pose for the camera, like, let's put on. But it's like, I feel like people get so invested in these relationships, in these couples. But it's almost like you can't allow all these different energies and opinions in your marriage. Because when you post it, even if you're super transparent, like this one lady posted something and she's like, the caption, she posted something on TikTok and she's like, the caption was something along the lines of, he cheated, we worked it out, and like she was dancing on the video. I can't even begin to tell you the comments from these women.
Yeah.
And it's like, maybe a delivery could have been better. I know what she was trying to get at, but it's just like, again, you are allowing too many people's opinions, but you should not. It's a marriage, two people. Mm-hmm. You should not allow everybody's opinions in there. So I do respect couples that, they may, hey, look at us. This is my husband. This is my person. Ladies, men, you know, there is a person out there for you, but I still feel like it should be kept private. Some things should not be for social media, like at all. Because it ain't nobody's business. You get people, even if you're like, oh, I'm not going to pay that stuff any mind, you do. In your quiet moments, you're like, is it someone else? You can't help it. Because the seed has been planted. It's back here.
Yeah.
Right up in that kitchen. It's back here. And you're like, who he's on the phone with? Out of nowhere. Your partner has never done anything to make you question. But because somebody commented something or made a bad guess or an opinion about something, now you're second guessing your partner. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. Because you can have 500 comments that were wonderful and that one person. Yep. Mm-hmm. And it stuck with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Because, I mean, also, you know, it's because it's your relationship. Like, it's something that's yours. It's personal. So you can say, oh, I don't pay that stuff any mind. Okay, girl. Sure.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. What inspired you to become a divorcee coach? What was the inspiration?
I feel like Black women, especially, we're so damaged. We're so bitter. There are a lot of trash men in this world, as there are trash women. I really wanted to focus on the healing for women, because it is so easy to just be bitter. It is so easy to be angry and mad and negative and pessimistic and believe that love doesn't exist, and you know, the next person is going to do this to me again. It's easy to do that. It's hard to heal. Those raw emotions and those raw feelings that you have to kind of like patch things back together. Mm-hmm. And then when you end up in a relationship, like the healing process is ongoing. You should always be trying to be better. I didn't date for a couple years after my separation. And when I got with my partner now, it was just frustrating because I thought I'd done the work, I'd done the healing, but it wasn't until I was in this relationship, I'm like, you're getting tested. You have to practice all of those things in the moment. You know, again, there were times when we would argue. We get the first ad. My eyes like filling it, but the first disagreement that we had, it was really weird because I was in my head, I was in my emotions again, not realizing that there were things that I was still healing from my marriage, you know, my first marriage. And during the disagreement, I started feeling myself being emotional and shutting down. And he walked over to me and like hugged me. And I was like, because I've never experienced that before. It's like, what is this? Healing is not like in 6 months, you should be straight. It is ongoing. And you should constantly be working on becoming better and being a better you. Because once you're a better you, you're a better partner.
Yes. I totally agree. I always tweet that self-awareness is top tier. Mm-hmm. Like self-awareness, people who take the time that's willing to do the work. One thing that I loved about my wife was she was willing to read books with me. Because I was like, that's just me. I need to be mentally stimulated. I mean, we can talk about whatever, but I need something where we having this conversation and we really get to know each other. So while we were dating long distance, I was like, hey, you want to read this book? She's like, yeah. And she wasn't even really a big fan. But for us to read 48 Laws of Power by Robert Greene, the whole book, well, we read like 90% of it because that's a dense book.
It is.
For us to go through that and have conversations, that was attractive to me because there was a girl that I dated previously before and we were just talking, but she was just like, I'm not into reading. That's really not my thing. And I respect that. And I'm glad that she told me. So that way I knew how to move forward with that because that's important. Because even to this day, we read books together before we go to bed. I just think that's a different level of intimacy.
Definitely. But every couple has its thing. I am the same way. Like, I need intellect. I need mental stimulation. Some people aren't like that. They like to go party. They like to go dancing. You have to find somebody that just kind of meshes well with you. You can't, what works for me may not work for another woman. And so don't look and compare my situation to yours. You got to find what works for you.
Yeah. No relationship is cookie cutter. I believe there are some principles that's kind of universal, but the way you grew up and the way I grew up, our backstories are totally different. You just never know. And I think it's important to know your significant other backstory so that way you know where they're coming from, because it's hard, you know, old habits die hard. You know, the way you were raised.
Yeah.
So
facts, right?
I was reading your Twitter because, you know, I'm a Twitter fan.
Lord.
Yeah.
Okay.
You had a lot of stuff that I could have pulled from, but I said, you know what? I got to ask her about this because I thought it was great, but I want you to expound on it.
Oh, Lord. Okay.
In a tweet, you said, ladies, if you're not gassing your man up, trust me when I say that there's a bald-headed hoe trying to hype him up.
I said what I said, and I said what I said.
Let's talk about it.
Listen, men may not say it. They may not say they enjoy it, men want to be valued and appreciated and coddled, and all the things that women talk about that they want, we verbalize it. Tell me I'm pretty. Men want that too, in their own way. A man has to feel like a man. And I know there are a lot of women, oh my God, I'm so tired. No, just like you want to be in your feminine energy and in full femininity, a man has to be in that as well. And if he's not, if there's a void or emptiness, there is somebody that is willing to stroke his ego. Did you watch Insecure?
Yes.
The bald-headed hoe, Tasha, at the bank. He did not go there because he respected his relationship, but it felt good for him to receive that attention from a woman. So again, gas him up or somebody else will. Trust.
Yeah. And that's real, because I have seen beautiful women get cheated on by somebody that really didn't look as good as she did. Mm-hmm. And she's pissed because she's like, how are you going to cheat on me with her? Well, she was saying those words. She was gassing him up, speaking those words to him, because you was too cute to gas up your man. Mm-hmm. You know,
or you were focused on things and not focused on him. You weren't, so, you know, words of affirmation may not be every guy's thing, but when you see him dressed up or he about to go out with a fella, yes, grab his booty, girl, like do something. Let him know you the shit. You still the shit. And I see you. Mm-hmm. And we don't do that enough. We don't hype our man up enough. Mm-hmm. You know?
But where do you think that comes from? Do you think we just too busy? Or don't know the love language?
No,
or
like I don't even feel like it's not knowing the love language. I feel like women are in competition with their partners. And so he don't do that for me, so why am I doing it for him? While that may be true, while there may be validity in it, again, you can't continue to compare. Well, I'm not going to do this because he don't do this. How about you do it so you can show him what to do? You know? Again, like, my partner is not verbally expressive. I am going to hype you up. I am going to love on you the way that I want to love on you. But I'm also going to love on you that feeds your love language, the way that you want to be loved. Because I think that's something else that we have to understand. The way that I give love may not be how he wants to receive it. And so, for instance, I could say, okay, gifts. That's a love language for me. And so I want to keep buying him stuff. And he's like, I don't want this. I want quality time. And I could get frustrated because I'm like, every time I go out, I go buy something. That's, you're not, this is for me. I'm feeding him this way because this is how I want him to love me. It's not how he wants to be loved by me. So again, it's not just about learning your partner's love language, learning yours and how you want to receive it, but how you give it. Mm-hmm. And I think we don't know that difference. There's this place of frustration, for instance, because men, because they are who they are providers. So, you know, a man might go buy his wife a car and she's like, well, I would have rather you just be at home more with the kids and I, instead of working all these hours for this car that I didn't need. And then what's going to happen? Who's going to be pissed off? He just did back-breaking stuff. Sacrifice whatever it is that he sacrificed so that he could buy her this big thing. And she's like, oh, that's cute. But the thing that I would have valued is you coming home earlier from work. You're not working all these hours. So you got to understand not just how you love, but how your partner wants to receive love as well.
Yeah, because that's where the rubber meets the road, because you got to think outside of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And act accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Yeah, because my wife, she loves gifts and she loves acts of service. So I'm always cleaning up something or or buying her something, because I'm like, okay, and that's cool. That's what she likes. But, you know, for me, I like words of affirmation. I like to be gassed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Any parting words of wisdom for those who are listening and watching today?
I knew this was coming, and I normally like try to have like a good nugget. Let me see. Yeah, you could have told me this before. Let me think. Don't get comfortable. So whether it's in the bedroom with your partner, when you're going through things, life, because life is life, okay? 2022, life was just happening. It was just so much stuff. COVID, we're kind of still on lockdown, not really. Sometimes, even with the situation with Twitch, sometimes your partner, especially men, our Black men are hurting so badly. The things that they have to deal with, that they may not speak about every day, the challenges that they face being a man, being a Black man, they may not come home and complain about it, because why? Do men do that? Do men express and talk about emotions? No. Let alone speak about the frustrations of what they may be experiencing each day. And I feel like as women, we get complacent, lazy. There may be so many other things that you're juggling. Your job, if you're an entrepreneur, your children, if they are into different activities. Granted, like sometimes we are doing a lot and there's a lot moving, but sometimes you got to take a minute to always pay attention to your partner. Hey, are you okay? I just need to check in with you today. I love you. Well, go give him a hug. Even if it looks like he's annoyed, men appreciate that. Men, just as we want to be seen, they want to be seen. They want to be appreciated. They want to be needed. And so there's this conversation of, I'm an independent woman and I don't need a man. I am very independent, but I always tell my partner, I need you. And not just saying it because it sounds good, but letting him know, like, hey man, like, I need you to make me smile. I need you to be silly. I need these things from you because it gives me peace. It gives me joy. If we aren't feeding them and giving them things and they don't feel like they're being seen by us, like I said on the Twitter post, there's a bald-headed hoe who's going to stroke his ego and make him feel special. And, you know, not saying that it's always going to happen because there are good Black men out here, but take your time and feed your partner and pay attention to what's going on with him. When he's quiet or you notice something has shifted, or you, if you're connected with someone, you know when something is off. And he may not, chances are he's probably not going to tell you. Even if there's times when I will literally just go sit next to him. He's playing on the Xbox or whatever, the PlayStation. I don't know what it is. That thing, the game thing. And I'll just sit there and share space with him. And it just lets him know she's here and she sees me. But sometimes y'all don't want us to talk. Y'all just want to know that we care. Y'all don't want us asking, what's wrong? What's wrong? What's wrong? Y'all just want to know she sees me. She notices something is off and she cares. And sometimes that may make you open up. Sometimes you just appreciate the sharing space together. So care enough to not be complacent, care enough to pay attention, even when life is chaotic and you are juggling everything. Again, not downplaying what we do as women, but pay attention to your partner.
I love that. Those are words of wisdom. I love it, because sometimes we can get complacent. You with somebody for 4 or 5 years and you just used to them doing whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important that you be intentional and you give them that quality time or whatever that they desire, because I know even transparent moment, right? Because even for my wife and I was dealing with some stuff and I'm just like, I don't know if I want to say anything. I'm thinking this to myself. And here it is. This is my wife. And I'm thinking, I don't want to say anything because
you don't want to burden her.
Exactly. Yep. Yep. I was like, I don't want to say anything. Yeah. Right. Because I'm like, she got all this stuff on her plate. If I say this, it's not that she can't handle it, but it's more of like me putting more on her plate. And I struggle with it. And this is today. I'm just like, ugh. And sure enough, came home. She made dinner and she sat down and we talked and I just told her, you know, no judgment, you know, she was just like, how can I help, you know, whatever. And I felt better. but I struggle with that. You know, we 5 years in and I still struggle as a man just trying to keep it all together.
So here's the thing that I had to learn the hard way. Y'all 5 years in, but how old are you?
I'm 45.
You 45 years in of being this way. Mm-hmm. And so you're 5 years trying to like undo 45 years of, you know, things that are natural and comfortable for you. And so even for me, you know, I do the same thing. And with my partner, I'm like, I get irritated, I get frustrated, but it's like, he's been this way all his life. So I can't expect rapid change. Like, it's not real. It's not sincere. And so don't beat yourself up when you're having those moments. You gotta, it's the growth process. It's just like, you know, that compromise of trying to like shift into, okay, I have someone to lean on. I have someone that can just listen to me. It's a process. Mm-hmm. I have so many things that I'm working on right now that I do not excel in, but it's a process, and you just have to remind yourself, like, I've been this way, or she's been this way her entire life. So I have to allow grace, and you have to allow yourself grace. So it's not just about her, it's about you as well. Mm-hmm. Like, give yourself grace. It's hard.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that, grace, because we don't talk about that word enough.
We don't. Yeah. And it's, you know, it's this mentality of, you know, we got to go hard. You got to keep going. No, sometimes you got to chill. Sometimes you got to rest and recuperate. You know, we have to just allow ourselves a minute to just breathe and to just be. It doesn't always have to be going nonstop. That is not healthy. And so if, you know, this whole self-talk, and if grace is, you know what, I'm not going to do anything today but lay in my bed and watch TV, and I'm not going to feel guilty for that. I'm going to let the kids cook tonight because I'm tired. Mm-hmm. And they have to give me grace. And okay, you know what, we got you, Mom.
Yeah.
It goes so many different ways.
Yeah. I said, y'all having pizza tonight? Go ahead and eat some pizza. I'm done. Yeah. Don't bother me.
Yeah. But like in the beginning, like when they were younger, I used to feel so bad. I'm like, oh my God, I gave my kids the frozen pizza. I'm such a bad mom. Really? But you cook 6 nights out the week. The one night you're gonna stop.
Yeah. Show yourself some grace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Yeah.
Well, this has been a phenomenal episode, Nyla. Thank you so much for taking some time out of your day to be a guest. Let everyone know how they can get in touch with you.
You guys can follow me on Instagram, Facebook at Nyla Carter, and Twitter as well.
Awesome, awesome. Yeah, so go check out those tweets, y'all.
Not that bad.
It's not. Brave Hearts community, make sure you hit the subscribe button. Make sure you share this video, or if you're listening via podcast, that you leave a rating and review. By doing so, it also leaves you in a drawing for a free Amazon gift card. Who doesn't like free Amazon gift cards? So make sure you leave that rating and review. Thanks again for listening and watching. This is Sean Heineman at It's Scary to Be Married, wanting you to love fearlessly. Take care, people.